Let's go out to Winnipeg now. Our good friend Brian Munn's joining us, newly of Golf Manitoba, but still with TSN on a freelance basis. How you doing, Munzie?
I'm great, Roddy. How are you guys, Dukes?
Real good
to talk again.
Yes, it always is good to talk. I don't know if you saw earlier. I said the number one question I have for you, and I don't mean to put you on the spot. This is what I want to come away with from the discussion with today. Have you ever added up your NHL, AHL, and WHL? Shoot, let's throw in SJHL broadcasts. Have you ever
number of games?
Yeah.
No. Well, you and I go back to the early 90s, right? So
when you were in high school,
if you were to start looking at, yeah, exactly. I was coming to hang out with you when you were the voice of the Raiders in Prince Albert, for crying out loud. So
yeah.
No, you know what? I haven't, but it's obviously in the thousands when you take a look at it. It's been fun. You know, it's been a great ride, and this is a new venture for me that I'm really excited about. You know my passion for golf and still being around the hockey world, so it's a great fit right now. And I've been around the group here at Golf Manitoba for 4 or 5 days and have had a lot of fun so far in the office, and found the trophies in the back here for your show here today, so it's all good.
Well, yeah, Munzie is the new director of communications for Golf Manitoba, and I texted you immediately as soon as I got that news, because I'm like, Munzie, you are going to love this, and I hope, looks like you are. I love golf too, I'm just crappy at it. Munzie, you're pretty good from what I understand.
Well, I think like every amateur golfer, some days are good, some days are bad, but I will say that I got my index down to a 4 last year, but I would imagine I'm probably more realistically around the 8-9 category. It's all the equipment, right? And you think of the fact, and our good friend Mike Langan in Saskatchewan has hooked me up with another set of the new TaylorMade Sim clubs for the Humboldt Broncos Memorial Golf Tournament again coming up, so they help me a lot in the summertime. There's no question about that.
You know,
we just got to get rid of the snow now.
Oh, yeah, I know. But as you know, yeah, see, you're a city kid. You don't get how the farmers are excited. Your dad would get it. You know what I mean?
Right.
Right.
But anyway, I know exactly what you're talking about.
Yeah. And listen, I want to talk Jets, but I know how big.
For sure.
But I know how big golf is, man. Like, the golf questions are coming in crazy. And that should not surprise anybody, eh, Dupes?
No, not at all.
Okay, one quick golf question, Munzie, and then to the Jets, okay? What's your favorite course in Manitoba, your favorite course in Saskatchewan, and then I know you take your sticks on the road with the Jets, or you have. What's your favorite course that you've played on the continent? Those three, name them.
Well, for me in Manitoba right now, Falcon Lake's hard to match. Like, I love going out there. But the great thing about this job, and there's 60-plus golf courses that are under the Golf Manitoba umbrella right now, and that number is continuing to grow by the day. So I've had a chance already to talk to a few of those clubs in the last week since coming on board here with them, of places, in all honesty, that I didn't know existed. So I'm excited about the opportunity to get out and see some of these new places. For me, back home, every summer we went to Waskasu. So the Lobstick Golf Club was the place that me and my mom and dad would spend a lot of time at in the summertime. And when I come back to see a lot of friends, obviously, from my time in northern Saskatchewan, if I get to one place, that's where I want it to be. And then you're right. Over the last 10 years with the Jets, and even the 5 years prior to that, calling Moose games in the American Hockey League, traveling around North America, I've had a chance to play some of the great golf courses in Canada and the U.S. Bethpage Black was pretty special just because you see it on television so many times. And it's tough. There's no question about that. And then so many others. But those are probably the three that really come to mind for me when you break it down. But we could, in all honesty, probably do a show for hours just on the great golf that we have in both Canada and the U.S. that we all love to play when the weather's right.
That's why I knew that this would be a perfect fit for you. You knew that it would be a perfect fit for you. On the weekend, I was saying to my wife, have you ever played Waskasu? And she's like, are you kidding? Like, she comes from a golf family, by the way. And she's like, yeah, golfed it every summer.
Yeah, I knew that.
Yeah, with my family. Oh, I could talk to you about this. I'll just say one last thing. Max Paddock, have you seen his mask with the Prince Albert Raiders, by the way? Have you seen it?
I have. I've watched a number of the Western League games out of the dome there, and it's been great to watch. And obviously, you know, you and I have so many close friend connections, let alone just watching from a hockey standpoint. that have gone through the bubble. And kudos to those guys. Kudos to the Western League for making it happen. And the sacrifice that the players and the coaches and the equipment staff and everybody that has made this thing happen to go through. I know they're on the back half now. The light's kind of getting a little bit brighter for them that is coming to conclusion. But it's been great. And I was talking to an NHL scout yesterday, actually, when I was driving around the city of Winnipeg here, that called in, and they've been really, really happy that they've had a chance to watch a number of these young players for the upcoming draft. So it's been a home run, and hopefully it's able to continue, and they finish it off here with the way it's gone here at the three-quarter mark.
As somebody said, it's the safest place on the prairies is the Dub Hub in Regina, and I would think it is. But just on that Max Paddock thing, his mask is of northern Saskatchewan. It just reminded me of floating on a boat in Emma Lake. That's what it looked like. I'm like, my God, whoever did that, what
absolutely.
A great job. Yeah. So Muncy to the Jets. They won in Ottawa last night, and I got to get your take on the addition of Jordy Benn. How are they looking going into the playoffs in your mind? Was it enough tinkering to make them a Stanley Cup contender?
Well, I think they are, just based on the fact that they have one of the best goaltenders in the National Hockey League in Connor Hellebuyck. You know, people in Tampa will argue that Vasilevsky is just as good and maybe better because he's got a Stanley Cup under his belt, but from watching him since he's come into the National Hockey League, it's hard to go against a guy like Hellebuyck. So when you've got a guy in net that is able to do that for you on a nightly basis and play as much as he has, that's a home run for the team right now. And Lauren Brossoit, like we saw last night in the nation's capital, came in and played a good game. So when they get to give Hellebuyck a break down the stretch here, they're able to do that. I like the addition of Jordy just based on the fact here that he's been around the league for a decade, right? He's got a lot of playoff experience under his belt with the teams that he's been with before, obviously the Benn family. And we all know his brother, Jamie, of course, and the Kelowna Rockets tie to everybody in the Western Hockey League. But Jordy's one of those guys that understands his role. And I think that's the biggest thing that the Jets were looking for. Would it have been great to add a Matthias Ekholm or a Josh Manson? Oh, absolutely it would. But they weren't able to make it happen because, as we all know, you have to give something to get something, right? And they weren't ready to mortgage the future with a number of young, really solid players that are going to be big stars for this club down the road right now and get rid of those guys. So, you know, Jordy's going to be a really good depth player. They've got enough experience on the back end, I think, that's been able to grow over the last few years, led by, well, you talk about a guy from Saskatchewan with his roots and a former Raider, led by Josh Morrissey on the back end. And really, when you look at up front right now, their four lines, when Kevin Cheveldayoff, the pride and joy of Blaine Lake, was able to add players like Nate Thompson and Trevor Lewis to round out their fourth line coming into the year, and then when they made the Dubois Line A trade, I think it's hard to argue right now that they've got a better set of 12 forwards than, or really when you break it down, another team that could say they have a better group. So I think this club can make a long run. But I give Kyle Dubas a lot of credit with Toronto as well. Bringing Nick Foligno in was a pretty good move for them.
Well, Muncy, I want to talk about the ice too, so just hang on. I'm not going to get specific with you, just about the franchise. But first, you were there calling the play-in round loss to the Flames last year. And Connor Hellebuyck, I'm sorry, I felt, was out goaltended by Cam Talbot. Brian Little got hurt. He hasn't come back. You don't have Line A now. Believe me, I'm pulling for the Jets. But is there something that they took out of that series that they'll learn from this time around, do you think?
Well, don't forget they didn't have Mark Scheifele in that playoff series too. So when you lose your number one center, it kind of, as soon as Line A and Scheifele went down, everything just kind of seemed to go in the toilet, and it was quick. And give Calgary credit, boy, they were playing some outstanding hockey. Jeff Ward had everything going for them at that point. And then you look at this year, and you know, you and I talked about it coming into the season. I think we all expected the Calgary Flames to be a lot better than where they sit right now, and you know, it's just been a disaster for Brad Treliving, and he's had to make another coaching change this year. So I think all the experience Winnipeg has going back to the Final Four a few years ago when they made it to the conference final against the Vegas Golden Knights has been something that they've been able to build upon, and now they'll try and use that with those players that we talked about earlier on.
And last one on tonight. Producer Clark points out Jets Leafs tonight with Austin Matthews out for the game. Should be interesting. Is there a buzz that this might be a playoff preview in the 204, Munsey? What's the anticipation of the game?
Well, based on the win last night, it got Winnipeg back within 5 points of Toronto. And based on the fact there's still three games remaining after tonight, you do the math. If the Jets are able to take advantage of Toronto in this series they're playing themselves, then they control their own destiny. But I don't really know if finishing first in this Scotia North Division right now is the be-all and end-all. It'd be great to hang a banner inside Bell MTS Place for sure and have the big bragging rights, which I think everybody likes to have, especially with this 1 year as to how this whole thing is playing out. But all in all, I'm just excited to see how the regular season finishes off now that the deadline's done, the players are set, rosters are ready to go. Let's get going.
I promised I would talk about the ice, and I mean, they gave me a gift bag of gear. I absolutely love it. I love their gear. I loved it back to the Edmonton Ice days, man, 24 years ago.
Yes.
And James Patrick, because it really hasn't changed, but James Patrick said to me, hey, he's like, you know the quality of hockey here. We just need to get the word out in Winnipeg and pack the Wayne Fleming Arena. Right. And I know they haven't broken ground on the new one. Do you think that major junior hockey in Winnipeg could become a real thing where they're selling out in a new arena? Because it's a crowded hockey marketplace, as Jeep pointed out.
Well, it is, and that was kind of the question when they came out of Cranbrook is how it would fit. But when you take a look at the landscape here, to answer your question in short term, absolutely. Now, they are a little bit behind the eight ball because playing on campus right now, there's no other stuff going on inside the arena. There's no other entertainment value where you're literally just going to watch the game and then you leave. But when they're able to get the new facility here, I know that Greg Fettis and Matt Cockle have done a tremendous job in behind the scenes, just trying to get things in motion for the new arena here at some point. And we're all kind of waiting to hear exactly when that may happen. But you know as well as me, on the prairies, we've all grown up around junior hockey. And the neat thing now, like you look at Peyton Krebs, right? Like he had a chance to get a little bit of taste with the Vegas Golden Knights. And he's a household name here in the city of Winnipeg. So as the Ice are able to grow young players and kind of have them their own and then watch that first Winnipeg Ice player make it to the NHL, whether it's as a Jet or come back and play here against Winnipeg, I think that's when you really get excited about the franchise. But there's no doubt. Like, I've gone to a number of games when the schedule's permitted, and I grew up with the league. You know that, and I'm a big fan of it. So I think it's going to continue to grow. But they do have their work cut out for them just based on the fact that you've got the NHL, the American League, you've got the university teams, you've got the MJ, and then you've obviously got AAA and minor hockey. So there's a lot of entertainment dollars right now that are being stretched for sure.
That's why I joke with my Winnipeg friends. Look, you're the hockey capital in Winnipeg. We're the football capital. We'll take that. You're the hockey. And they seem to be okay with that. And you mentioned Peyton. What, you don't like that? Listen, let's move on. Peyton Krebs, is. We're seeing him for another 10 days.
I'm just wondering who the defending cup champions are. I'm just curious.
Stop. Yeah, then the world ended, Munsey.
I can't believe I'm doing that right now.
I know. Yeah, you won't be allowed back over the border. Anyways, Krebs is leaving within, yeah, that's right, that's true, within 10 days or so, but then you got more coming up with Connor Geeky and a lot of great young guys. Wayne Jones, right. Viewer, he's watching on YouTube, he just says, ask Munz about the future of the ice since they're not planning for a new barn in the city. Are they relocating? They're not going anywhere. They're in Winnipeg to stay. We'll see how this all plays out. Yeah. And I think that's probably all I had for you, my friend. Anything else on your mind?
All right. No. You know what? I'm just having a blast right now. Just kind of getting into the new role here and looking forward to getting out and playing a little golf. And then, you know, as we joke back and forth about the Blue Bomber Rough Rider rivalry right now, see what's happening with the Canadian Football League. And, you know, when it's safe to do so, obviously, that's the most important thing right now for everybody. Whatever we're all doing is staying safe through COVID right now, but trying to get back to a little bit of a normal lifestyle when summer comes here and get back and see a lot of people, obviously, that I miss back in my home province.
Well, we're getting there. Munsey, thanks for the time. Congrats again. Yeah. Keep in touch, brother.
Absolutely, Roddy. Take care.
Brian Biggie Munz. The only guy that calls on that is John Lynch, but I like it. From Golf, Manitoba, longtime NHL, AHL, WHL broadcasters.
You're watching Rod Peterson On Demand. For more of The Rod Peterson Show, visit rodpeterson.com or follow Rod Peterson on social media.